director of 97%, a group, of course, working to reduce gun violence. And good to have you weigh in on this. The word here needs to be incremental, right? It was clear that after the Texas shooting, that any deal, any at all, would be better than no deal. But do you believe the measures as outlined so far can save lives?
Well, good question, Paul, and thanks for having me on. So, yes, I believe that they could save lives. It's very important. This is not a great deal, but it's a great deal, right? Because it's amazing that we got anything at all. Who knew even a few weeks ago that anything would happen? Any type of legislation was a long shot. There's a bunch of stuff in here, and it's very important, Paul, for the audience to understand, 45,000 gun deaths in the U.S. a year. This legislation is not getting that to zero. But can you make any difference and save some lives? I'm inclined to think with this legislation, absolutely yes.
Well, that's the most optimistic thing I've heard in years from any group trying to get to gun reform. Let's try and dive deeper, though, into these proposals. They don't ban any type of gun or ammunition. So we just talked about it, right? There's this red flag provision for states. If they choose to take those grants, potentially guns could be confiscated from those deemed dangerous. And that brings up a key point, right? Do you think states could try and sidestep or override this in any way, even if it is a bipartisan success?
It's always possible, and states could end up suing. That's always possible. But red flag laws have been proven to be effective. And so 19 states in the U.S. already have them. Let's take Florida, for example, which has a conservative governor, right? Now, you would think that maybe Florida would sue. No, Florida likes the red flag law. They've taken away over 8,000 guns from people deemed a danger to themselves or others. So having these laws in more states around the country can only be helpful. So yes, there is some reason for optimism. Again, Paul, it doesn't solve all the problems, but something like a red flag law can be effective and can save lives. So I do anticipate seeing that in more states around the country.
Yeah, and again, so much of that progress unfortunately came after Parkland, right? After that terrible school shooting. Now, this could possibly include diving into those juvenile records, and this means going into those background checks, right? Whatever went on with someone before the age of 18. Is that real progress? And a direct question to you, would it have prevented, in your opinion, the Buffalo or Uvalde shooters from obtaining guns? And I'm going to stress this point. They obtain those guns legally.
And I don't know the answer to that question, because I will tell you, Paula, if they couldn't obtain them legally, perhaps they would have obtained them illegally. Again, we can't prevent every shooting. There are 340 million people in the United States and 400 million guns. We cannot prevent every shooting. We can prevent some. So, for example, you're specifically focusing on mass shootings, which is important. There are 26,000 suicides a year in the United States with a gun. So if you have something like a red flag law where you're able to take the gun away from somebody temporarily, that could prevent a life from being taken, right? If you have, we have background checks, you mentioned, for 18-year-olds to 21-year-olds, we're going to have a deeper background check. So for example, so people know in the United States now, if that background check is not completed within 3 days, the person gets a gun very often, right? So this would prevent that. You would get to go longer for that background check for 18 to 21-year-olds. If you're able to prevent them from getting a gun when they may be a danger to themselves or others, you may prevent a mass shooting, but you also may prevent a suicide, which is the vast majority of gun deaths. Most people, 95% of people, if they try to commit suicide with a gun, they're succeeding. If they try any other way, they're not succeeding. So if somebody is going through something temporarily, a state of depression, PTSD, being able to prevent that, Paula, is so important. And this is why this is helpful legislation.
Yeah, it is such a tragic point, but important because sometimes, many times, those firearms come from within the home. They are firearms that are already legally within their own homes. Before I let you go, I want to talk about whether or not you're optimistic that this could actually provide some momentum. Perhaps not in this Congress, maybe in the one, after the midterms. Or do you worry sometimes that this could be celebrated as some kind of bipartisan win, and yet we'll still be looking at the same statistics in 2023, 2024?
Great questions. And the answer is we're going to be looking at bad statistics. The Supreme Court is going to make it easier for people to carry guns in public places very soon, right? So we're still going to be looking at bad statistics. But as you say, Paula, there is some momentum. It doesn't mean that things are going to happen in the next year or two, but you first have to prove that you can get bipartisan legislation, Senator John Cornyn from Texas, Senator Chris Murphy from Connecticut, very across the aisle from each other, really made this thing happen with a group of 20 out of 100 bipartisan efforts to make this happen, to make sure that we have less of these mass shootings and less of these suicides. And that's the first step, Paul. Let's see how this works. It's obviously going to be a couple of years before we see new legislation, but let's see how this works. And keep in mind something we talk about all the time. Gun owners are on board with this. Gun owners want this legislation. Gun owners want less gun deaths in the United States. And it's been a very tough hill to climb, but I think that this is a very important step.
Yeah, and so crucial that you point that out. It's bipartisan, but also reflected in Americans' thinking. Even at the NRA convention that we had a few weeks ago, they were saying they want some of this. Matthew Lipman,
also,
again.
Let me just add one more thing.
Yep.
Thing from a person. 80% of NRA members want background checks. So there's no reason for us not to be doing all these things that Congress is doing. We can do more, but you can't let the perfect be the enemy of the good.
Okay. Matthew, we'll leave it there for now. We'll wait to see the details of this new proposal. Appreciate it.